And now we will continue with our next panel. The subject of our new panel is how can the private sector advance gender equality and women's empowerment? Our moderator is Ms. Meral Güzel, Regional Coordinator for Europe and Central Asia, UNWomen Empower Women from Turkey. Ms. Asma Ennaifer, Director External Affairs, RSE and Innovation from Orange, from Tunisia. Ms. Najma Jabri, Senior Manager, Retail and Strategic Segments, Gulf African Bank Limited from Kenya. Anne Rosenberg, Senior Vice President, Global Head of SAP NextGen, and Mr. Bora, Tuncer, General Manager, Schneider Electric from Turkey.
Merhabalar, biz panelimize başlıyoruz. Çok fazla zamanınızı da almak istemiyorum, tam yemek öncesi olduğunu biliyorum. İngilizce devam edeceğim ben bundan sonrasını. So thank you very much for coming and choosing this panel and staying instead of going to lunch. And all other panelists of the Bosphorus Summit have been dealing with the politics and the economics of scarce resources, energy and gas, pipeline, petroleum. We will deal here, we will discuss the most untapped resource and I would say the vested asset, which is woman economy. I will just present first our panelist, Anne Rosenberg. She is the Senior Vice President, Global Head of SAP NextGen. Asma Ennaifer, sitting next to me, Director of External Affairs, CSR and Innovation of Orange Tunisia. Bora Bey, Bora Tuncer, Cluster President of Turkey, Iran, Central Asia of Schneider Electric. And Najma Jabri is the Senior Manager of Retail and Strategic Segments at Gulf African Bank. So this panel will showcase the experiences and the good practices of how all those four different companies and having advanced in gender equality and women's empowerment. So why we are talking about gender, private sector supporting gender equality? Gender equality, as we always talk, is a fundamental right. And even though there is some improvement in the economy, and unfortunately, as of today, women and girls cannot really exercise this right at all levels of the society, in management, in the economy. When we empower women, and there are number means like more than 100 studies that show that when we empower women, nations and companies together and private sector together, they benefit from this. So how economies benefit from gender equality? And again, I'm sure all of us have already heard about the IMF research and the Women Matters studies that show that when global economy could be designed in such a way that all men and women could enjoy and enter the workforce at an equal way, equally, this could up 28 trillions up the global GOP. And actually, there is also specific country-specific studies on that for Europe, for US, and for Japan. And I want to mention Japan here, that with 16%. They took it very seriously, and the Japanese government made a mandate of women empowerment, and they push companies or empower companies so that they can empower and women. And we say women play a key role also to sustainable economy for several ways. First, for the alleviation of poverty, of course. Second, the creation of jobs for other women. Women empower other women, and women employ other women. And they provide innovation, and again, showcased several times by the studies, and they increase the local supply. When we invest in women, this comes back to the society and to the households in terms of better housing. When women hold the control of the economics of the family, and it improves the better health for the children, better education, and more girls going to the school, and better health for the families. And if they are women entrepreneurs, they reinvest back to their businesses. And the latest study on this, I love that study, when women make their earnings, 98% globally comes back either to the societies where they live or to the households, whereas for men, this is between 30 to 40 levels. 40%. So here I give the floor to Anne, so she will explain how well they are doing in SAP to advance gender equality. Thank you, Anne.
It's got a really great ride. So thank you so much for giving me the opportunity to come and speak. UNWomen have a very special place in my heart, and I'm actually working with UNWomen on a campaign called She Innovates, and I will come back to that shortly. It's actually so special that every day I'm wearing this bracelet here, which has the symbol of UNWomen, and it is a movement where I'm inspiring other women around the world to join that movement. So being a woman, and you might hear on my dialect that I'm not from Turkey, and I'm actually from Denmark, but I live in half of my time in Silicon Valley and in New York. I have a global responsibility, and I work with what I call the next generation who is entering the work market. SAP is one of the biggest software companies in the world. We are in more than 180 countries around the world. And we actually have more than 365,000 companies who run SAP and more than 17,000 partners. That means that we are talking about a huge community, a huge ecosystem of cooperation, partners, governments, education institutions, who is part of this huge ecosystem. So working in a software company, and as you might know today, every single industry is becoming a technology industry. So SAP cover more than 25 industries, so we go from fashion to healthcare to manufacturing. It's very interesting, and that's why I am deeply thankful to UN, and I was speaking at UNIDO yesterday in Austria. I'm deeply thankful to the whole UN family, how they're positioning the 17 global goals, where the topic here is that we talk about gender equality, goal number 5. The thing about the 17 global goal is that that was invented and presented for 2 years ago. And as you might know, we have less than 5,000 days to reach the 2030, to reach the goals, is that those 17 global goals, if you put them in front of the word digital transformation, which is what each and every company is going through today, each and every government institution is going through today, you are actually able to do a purposeful digital transformation. And that's where I see the uniqueness of the opportunity of being a woman in today. People are often asking me, why do I believe that we are at the moment right now where we will see a change? Women will get a big voice at the innovation table. It has to do with how we are getting together right now. With the 17 global goals, you actually have a foundation where governments, universities, corporations are getting together and agreeing together with citizens that if we work on the 17 global goals, we are actually able to reach a better future. So therefore, if I look at SAP as a company, actually around 76% of all food moved from A to B today is done within the SAP ecosystem. And that is actually a lot. And I can keep on coming with numbers like this. And that's why I believe that SAP as a company, if we together with our SAP ecosystem, can go in and redefine business processes based on all the new exponential technologies and put in mind that women, first of all, need to have a seat when we talk about innovation. So when that innovation conversation is going on, they need to have a seat at the table, including the way we are defining the future, whatever we are in the private sector or we are in the public sector, that we give women the rights they need and the voice they need. And that's why I believe that goal number 5 is not just a goal on its own. Goal number 5 go across all the 17 global goals. So at SAP, because we are a software company, we have decided, first of all, that we support the 17 global goals. We have decided, every single woman in SAP have decided that we want to step up and we want to be role models. We want to inspire women in the world to go into technology. Because as I said in the beginning, every single industry becomes a technology company. So you cannot neglect not to understand technology today. Everybody needs to have a basic understanding of technology. And that's why it's important that we make it available for every single person in the world. So at SAP, more than 25% of women is in leadership position. And if you look at SAP, we have many, many networks for women inside the company. But what we also do a lot is that we actually open up to the ecosystem and really have a whole, I call it the platform, for inviting women from our ecosystem, and that includes high schools, universities, and our entire partner ecosystem, to have a conversation about being a woman in technology today. And that's why, to give some examples that you can see up on the slide, we teamed up with UNWomen on a concept which is called She Innovates. We didn't do this alone. We actually launched this in September in New York, and we did it together with... Let's see if I get this one working here. Oh, no. Can I get the magic? Oh, that's the magic. That was great. We did that together with a number of companies from the corporate world and also from academia. All these companies have come together as a coalition to say, you know, talking about that we do need to do something about getting women a voice is not enough. We need to build a platform. And the platform is a platform where we simply are building up a whole global network around the world where we inspire women to come into a network where you can become an ambassador, you become a mentor, You can set up meetups, you can open a chapter. And we are coming up with an app beginning of the year, which is really like, I always call like the best friend in your pocket for women to go into the technology world, whatever you want to be an entrepreneur, you want to be a thought leader in blockchain, machine learning. This is a place where you get access to a virtual skill school. It's a place where you get access to a mentor network. It's an access where you get access to, is there any meetup going on in my area? It's a place where you can sign up to become a mentor, an ambassador. It's a place where you can go in and get help for your startup or venture capital. So that app will support the platform. So no matter if you're a woman in Nigeria, in Istanbul, in New York, in Silicon Valley, you can literally go in and see what is happening in my city. Is there a meetup going on? Is there a network of women who is into blockchain? And you can get together and you can help each other, because that is really what will make the change. So it is a movement, and it is clearly a strong movement. And within SAP, we as a company, all the women within SAP, we have decided that we want, because we represent one of the biggest software companies in the world, we want to represent and be a strong voice in that conversation in the world. As mentioned earlier, SAP is in 180 countries. We have a network of 3,200 universities. My team is opening up an innovation lab every single week around the world. It's time to act. It's time to get women in and have a conversation about technology. I will leave with a note on this, because I deeply believe that the change is happening. And why do I say that? In the work that I do with my team around the world, I see that women today, and we have a program called Young Thinkers, where high schools are educating students on coding skills, design thinking skills, science fiction skills, all the different kind of STEM skills which is required today. And we see many more girls signing up to those classes. So we also see that universities, that many more women are signing up to the more STEM-oriented classes. So the change is happening. And I think one of the reasons why the change is happening is that we need to remember that the people who will be driving businesses in 2030, where we need to reach the 17 global goals, is the people who is getting out of universities right now. And we are seeing that the young people, they look at things differently, like my generation, for example, is doing. So the change is happening really, really rapidly. But change will never happen if the change doesn't start with yourself. So you as a woman and you as a man, first of all, the whole bias that you have towards women or the stereotype that you have towards women, it needs to change right there. You need to look at people like human people, and you need to make sure that you mentor and coach and help other people. And then we always need to remember, we need to give more back than we take from this world. And I will just tell you one thing, if we leave half of the population out of the innovation conversation that is going on right now, using all the great new technologies and capabilities that we have from all the expensive technologies, we are not able to rapidly enough benefit from the technology would exist today. So therefore, I kindly ask all the audience, everybody listening online, the change, you need to change first the way you look at other people, and then for all women out there, step up and join the C-Innovate movement.
Thank you very much. We are returning to Asma. Asma represents the telecommunication company Orange in Tunisia. And we will need an Arabic translation for that.
Assalamu alaikum. من قبل بدي نقول شكرا لليو ان وومن للاستضافه دي. Thank you very much, Meral. أنا اليوم عايزة أعطيكم بسطة عن برامج أورانج تونس لتدعيم المرأة التونسية ولتمكينها اقتصادياً. دونك اليوم سأقدم لكم دور التكنولوجيا الرقمية في تدعيم التمكين الاقتصادي للمرأة، وسأمدكم بأمثلة من برامج أورانج لتدعيم المرأة. المرأة التونسية تحظى بمكانة هامة في المجتمع التونسي وتعد نموذجاً يحتذى به في العالم العربي والإفريقي بفضل الحقوق المكتسبة للمرأة التونسية، فضلاً عن إسهاماتها وسعيها الدائم إلى تنمية قدراتها على تحمل المسؤولية في مختلف القطاعات. الأرقام اللي عندنا في تونس في 2017 66% بس من الحاملات الشائد العليا هم إناث، بس المشكل هو 36% بس من الإناث دول عندهم شغل. القوة العاملة في النسبة دي في القوة العاملة في مختلف القطاعات، لذلك وضعت أورانج تونس برنامجاً خاصاً لدعم الفتيات والنساء بمختلف الشرائح الحمرية والاجتماعية من خلال ترسيخ ثقافة التكنولوجيا الرقمية للمرأة، باعتبار أن المهن المستقبلية تعتمد أساساً على التكنولوجيات الحديثة وتساهم في توفير مواطن شغل جديدة. في هذا الإطار أولت أورانج تونس أهمية قصوى للعنصر النسائي في صيغة استراتيجيتها الهادفة إلى التركيز على المرأة في كل مشاريعها ومبادراتها والاهتمام بالفتيات والنساء والحرفيات من خلال العمل على تحفيزهن وتشجيعهن على الابتكار وبعث المشاريع اعتماداً على التكنولوجيا الحديثة في مختلف القطاعات. إزاي بدأنا البرامج دول؟ وتأكدت أولى الخطوات بالنسبة لأورانج تونس عبر انخراطها في الميثاق العالمي لحقوق الإنسان سنة 2012 وتوقيعها على مبادئ دعم المرأة لويبس لهيئة الأمم المتحدة للمرأة خلال شهر جانفي 2016، واعتمادها على رؤية واستراتيجية اتصالية هادفة وشاملة من أجل التمكين الاقتصادي للمرأة بالتعاون مع المنظمات، مع الحكومات، مع الجمعيات والمؤسسات الحكومية. دونك كل برامج اللي عملنا عليها دايما في partnership مع public sector، مع عند ال NGOs. الشراكة ما بين القطاعين العام والخاص شراكة هادفة وتمثل آلية بين القطاعين العام والخاص محركا للتنمية ومحفزاً اقتصادياً لخلق مواطن شغل جديدة للمرأة. وفي هذا الإطار أطلقت أورانج تونس العديد من البرامج والمبادرات لدعم التمكين الاقتصادي للمرأة ونشر ثقافة بعث المشاريع والمبادرة لدى النساء والفتيات. البرنامج الأول هو يعد إطلاق برنامج التربية الرقمية الموجهة لتلاميذ المدارس الابتدائية دليلاً ملموساً على رؤية واستراتيجية أورانج تونس في تدعيم الشراكة بين القطاعين الخاص والعام، وكذلك تحسين النتائج المدرسية للتلاميذ وتطوير مهاراتهم وتنمية قدراتهم في استعمالات التكنولوجيا الحديثة ونشر الثقافة الرقمية لدى التلاميذ خاصة منهم الفتيات. ومنذ انطلاق هذا البرنامج سنة 2014 شمل هذا البرنامج النموذجي 60 مدرسة في المناطق الريفية في مختلف أنحاء الجمهورية. وقد ساهم برنامج التربية الرقمية في تحقيق نتائج إيجابية جدا منذ انطلاقه من خلال تقليص نسبة الانقطاع المدرسي لدى الفتيات التي بلغت نسبة 2% في المناطق الريفية بعدما كانت النسبة تتجاوز 30%. البرنامج الثاني هو البرنامج بتاع تكنوفيشن. البرنامج ده هو تعزيز أورانج تونس مبادرتها عبر حضورها في المدارس الابتدائية والمعاهد الثانوية من خلال دعم الطاقات الشابة خاصة لدى الإناث بتنمية قدراتهن وتدريبهن وتبني أفكارهن، في حيث وفرت بالتعاون مع تكنوفيشن انترناشونال كل الظروف الملائمة للشابات اللواتي تتراوح أعمارهن بين 10 و18 سنة للمشاركة في مسابقة تكنوفيشن تونس بهدف خلق مجالات جديدة للإبداع والابتكار لدى الفتيات. والبرنامج التالي هو برنامج البيوت الرقمية. البيوت الرقمية وصلت أورانج تونس تبني نفس التوجه بإطلاقها لبرنامج البيوت الرقمية بدعم من مؤسسة أورانج فونديشن بشراكة مع القطاع العام وجمعيات ومنظمات المجتمع المدني. ويهدف هذا البرنامج إلى تكوين وتدريب النساء في المناطق الداخلية وخاصة المرأة الريفية على كيفية استخدام التكنولوجيا الحديثة لتسويق منتوجاتها وإدارة مشاريعها بشكل مستقل وناجح. البيوت الرقمية لدينا 10 بيوت رقمية في مختلف ولايات الجمهورية تضم 600 امرأة و 200 فتاة شابة من حاملي الشهائد العليا. تعمل أورانج تونس على تكوين النساء دول اللواتي يمتلكن معرفة ودراية في مجال الصناعات التقليدية والحرف على استعمالات التكنولوجيا الحديثة معتمدة على نقل المعارف بين الأجيال، حيث يقمن بدورهن بتكوين الفتيات الشابات حاملات الشهائد العليا بهدف بعث مشاريعهن. تهدف أورانج من خلال تكوين الفتيات الشابة اعتماداً على التكنولوجيا الرقمية المحافظة على الموروث الحرفي والصناعة المتوارثة بين الأجيال ونقل المعرفة الحرفية وتأطيرهن لإطلاق مشاريعهن الصغرى من خلال استعمال التكنولوجيا الجديدة. آخر بروجكت هو أختيزاندار. أختيزاندار هي يعد مشروع أختيزاندار من المشاريع الهادفة لدعم التمكين الاقتصادي للمرأة الحرفية، ويمثل منصة رقمية تضم حوالي 1000 حرفية متواجدة على كامل أنحاء الجمهورية ولهم دراية وتجربة في قطاع الحرف والصناعات التقليدية على غرار صناعة النسيج، حياكة الزرابي والسجائد التقليدية والجلود والأحذية والفضة والمعادن والبلور والخزف والفخار. في ذلك هدفنا، هدف أورانج تونس هو يتمثل في التعريف بالمرأة التونسية وبالحرفيات التونسيات وبمنتوجاتها والتعريف بإبداعاتها وابتكاراتها إلى خلق جسر تواصل رقمي لمساعدة الحرفيات على تسويق منتوجاتهن وبيعها في السوق المحلية والعالمية. واليوم بفضل التطبيقة المبتكرة أختيزاندار شهدت المبيعات ارتفاعاً بنسبة 70% في ظرف 3 أشهر من تاريخ إطلاقها هذه التطبيقة المبتكرة. شكراً جزيلاً. الآن can pass video please.
كيف اللي تحبوا.
Thank you, Asma. It was very exciting to hear that thanks to this app, all the women entrepreneurs who could put their staff, the handicrafts, could have an increase of sale of 60% within 3 months, which is incredible. And here I'm turning to Bora Bey, who is our balance of gender equality in the panel, and he will explain what Schneider Electric has been doing to advance gender equality and women's empowerment. Thank you.
Okay. Şimdi tabii bir önceki panelin ve bu panelin tek erkek panelisti olmanın motivasyonuyla sizler de kaçmadan çok hızlı bir şekilde yani önce bir Schneider Electric nedir çok bir iki cümleyle, arkasından globalde hangi uygulamaları yapıp sonuçlar aldık, lokalde de ne yapıyoruz sizlerle paylaşmak istiyorum. Şimdi Schneider Electric kendisini global enerji uzmanı diye pozisyonlayan, efendime söyleyeyim, işte müşterilerin enerji yönetimlerini ve süreçlerini iyileştirmeyi teknolojiyle birleştirip onların hayatını kolaylaştırma amacıyla bir model kurmuş global bir şirket. Şirketin dünyadaki yaklaşık kilosu 25 milyar euro. Çalışanı 140-145 bin aralığında 100-150 tane, yani 140 tane ülkede operasyon yapıyor. Efendime söyleyeyim, önemli miktarda kazancının önemli bölümünde Ar-Ge'ye ayırıyor. Şirketin genel resmi bu olduktan sonra bu işte cinsiyet eşitliği konusunda şirket bugüne kadar nasıl yaklaştı konusuna girmek istiyorum. Şirketin aslında son dönemlerde değil, 2000'li yılların başından itibaren bu konuya ciddi bir fokusu var. Yani bunun sosyal ve ekonomik getirilerini erken anlamış ve bu sürede buraya yatırım yapmış bir şirket. Ben 2003 yılında katıldım. Bizim 2003 yılında yönetimde %30 kadınların minimum bulunması gibi hedeflerimiz vardı. Dolayısıyla şirket DNA'sında aslında bu konuyu önemsemiş ve bu konuda yol almış bir şirket. Bunun da arkasındaki temel gerekçesi şirketin dünyanın her tarafına yaygın, efendime söyleyeyim, farklı kültürlerden insanları bulunduruyor olması sebebiyle aslında bunun ekonomik değerine hissetmiş olması. Şu an itibariyle bile şirketin en üst yönetiminin tamamı hem cinsiyet anlamında hem de farklı milletlerden bulunma anlamında. Yani Çinli, efendime söyleyeyim, Amerikalı, işte Mısırlı, Fransız falan bütün farklı milletlerden oluşan bir yönetim olan bir şirket burası. Dolayısıyla aslında şirket bu konuyu reaktif değil, proaktif yöneten bir yapı olarak işte bu yıllara geliyor. Ve 2015 yılında cinsiyet eşitliği aksiyonlarında gösterdiği başarıdan dolayı da He for She Impact tarafından aslında ödüllendiriliyor. Fakat bu ödüllendirilme sürecinde yaptıklarının da ötesine geçmek için 3 tane konuda commitment'ta bulunuyor şirket. Sunumu biraz çevirebilir misiniz? Geçiyorum. Şimdi bu 3 tane alandan birincisi, çalışanlarının 2 yıllık süre içinde, yani 2017 yılının sonuna kadar %85'inin paketlerini, kazançlarını, maaşlarını gözden geçirmeyi ve kadınlarla erkekler arasındaki dengesizliği kapatmayı taahhüt ediyor. İkincisi, diyor ki ben işe alımlarımda alım pipeline'ının, yani görüşme yaptığım pipeline'ın minimum %40'ını kadınlardan oluşturacağım ve key position dediğimiz önemli rollere de minimum %30 kadın koyacağım diyor. Bunlar global olarak bütün ülkelere verilen hedeflerde yer alıyor. Çok net bir şekilde. Üçüncüsü de diyor ki bütün bunların gerçekleştiğini takip etmek için bir komite kurulacak. Hem globalde hem ülkelerde ve bu komiteler bu aksiyonların gerçekleştiğini takip edecek diyor. Yani çok net bir şekilde diyor ki dedikeyiz, biz bununla ilgili aksiyonları açık bir şekilde belirledik ve bunlar yapılıp yapılmadığını da takip edecek yetkili komitelerimiz var diyor. Bunun sonu ne oluyor? Bunun sonu bugün itibariyle çalışanların içinde şirketin %30'u kadın, %70'i erkek. 2016 yılındaki işe alımların, bu işe alımlar bakın sadece yönetici seviyesinde değil, teknisyen beyaz yaka tamamını kapsayacak şekilde %42'si kadın, %58'i erkek. Dolayısıyla aslına bakarsanız Schneider Elektrik'in yaptığı aksiyonların arkasında ve sonuç getirmesinin arkasındaki temel kriter nedir derseniz 4-5 tane önceliği belirlemiş olması, bunları da çok bir business, yani bir iş önceliği gibi indikatörlere koymuş olması ve bunları da diğer önceliklerine benzer bir şekilde takip etmiş olmasıdır. Ve Schneider Elektrik'te aslında bu konu globalde son derece şeydir, başarılı bir şekilde devam ediyor. Şimdi tabii bunu ne sağlıyor noktasına geri gelirsek, aslında bunu liderlik sağlıyor. Jean-Pascal Tricoire kendisi bunu bir misyon olarak edinmiş. Bildiğiniz farklı coğrafyalardaki liderlerle yarımşar günlük workshoplar yapmış ve bu workshoplarda mevcut, o bölgelerdeki mevcut cinsiyet oranının ne olduğunu, bunun arkasındaki gerekçelerin analizini, işte bunun gelişmesine engel olan noktaları ve bunların sonunda da her bir coğrafyada ya da ülkede bunlarla ilgili taahhütleri kendisi liderlik ederek tanımlamış. Ondan sonra da bunları çevresine tanımladığı liderlerin sahiplenmesi için benim de kendimin de dahil olduğum şekilde bunların Women Empowerment Principle'ları desteklemesini sağlayacak şekilde, ki bugün Schneider Elektrik'te üst yönetim yani ülke coğrafya başkanlarının 40 tanesi Women Empowerment Principle'ın gerçekleştireceğini, prensipleri hayata geçireceğini taahhüt etmiş, imzalamış arkadaşlarımızdan oluşmaktadır. Bunun devamı otomatikman geliyor. Bugün şirkette 38 bin çalışan he for she inisiyatiflerini bilfiil çalışmış ve keza imzalamış durumdadır. Dolayısıyla şirket açık bir şekilde ben eşitlik ve aidiyet kriterlerini sahipleniyorum. Liderden en ülkelerdeki orta seviyede yöneticilere kadar bunlarla ilgili inisiyatiflerimi ortaya koydum ve bunları regüler olarak takip ediyorum diyerek bu konuda yol almış bir organizasyon. Çok dediğim gibi çok detayına girmeyeceğim ama burada vurgulamak istediğim şey şu. Ne yapacağınızı açık aksiyonlarla belirlediğiniz ve organizasyonun liderlerinin bunu sahiplendiği, bunları da net ölçeklere koyduğunuz, KPI'lere koyduğunuz ve takip ettiğiniz durumda oluyor. Şimdi bunu aslında burada vurgulamak istiyorum. Bunun devamında tabii bizler bütün bu konuştuğum şeyleri, aksiyonları lokal olarak takip ediyoruz. Biraz daha Türkiye'ye özel neler yapıyoruz, ondan biraz bahsetmek istiyorum. Şimdi biz tabii bunların hepsini gerçekleştirirken kendi dinamiklerimizi de sahiplenecek şekilde Türkiye'de bir kısım projeler yaptık. Bir tanesi E-Sure Life diye bir proje yaptık. Çalışan kadınlarımızın tamamını, mavi yaka, beyaz yaka, yönetici ayrımı yapmadan hepsini bir araya getirdiğimiz bir platform kurduk. Regüler olarak bir araya geliyorlar. Kendi problemlerini, birbirleriyle bu problemleri nasıl yönettiklerini tartışıyorlar ve bize bir tavsiyeler listesi getiriyorlar. Ve biz bu listeyi düzenli olarak hayata geçirecek aksiyonlar tanımlıyoruz. Dolayısıyla öncelikle beraber çalıştığımız arkadaşlarımızın hayatlarını kolaylaştırmayı ve dolayısıyla da iş verimlerini, iş yaratıcılıklarını artırmayı hedefliyoruz. Ve bundan çok güzel sonuçlar aldık. Hem çalışan memnuniyeti anlamında hem çalışan yaratıcılığı ve katma değeri anlamında. Fakat burada bir noktaya iyi parmak basmak istiyorum. Bütün bu kadınlarımızın bir araya geldiği platformda dahi ana gördüğümüz şeylerden birisi şu, öğrenilmiş yanlış algılar var. Yani hani bu inançlar ezber şeklinde toplumun yıllarca bir şekilde işlediği, sadece erkeklerde yok, kadınlarda da var maalesef. İşte buradaki challenge'larımızdan ve aşmaya uğraştığımız zorluklarımızdan bir tanesi, ki ben bilfiil bunu kadın arkadaşlarımıza söylüyorum. Aslında öğrendiklerinden vazgeçmek, yeni bir dil tanımlamak, yeni bir doğru tanımlamak. Bunda mesela zorlanıyoruz. Tekrar söylüyorum, bunu kadınlarımızda zorlanıyoruz. Bakın erkeklere gelmedim daha. Tamam mı? İşte bu yeni dili tanımlama konusunda özel çaba sarf ediyoruz. demin panelist arkadaşlarımızla da, panel öncesindeki konuşmalarımızdan birisine de burada vurgulamak istiyorum. Aslında burada şöyle bir gerçek var. Ben 2010 yılına kadar yönetime girmiş başarılı kadın çalışan arkadaşlarımıza da baktığım zaman gördüğüm gerçeklerden birisi şudur ki bu değişiyor ve çok mutlu edici. Aslına bakarsanız erkekler gibi davranan kadınların başarılı olduğu bir dönem yaşadık. Kadınlara kadın olarak, kadınların dinamikleriyle başarılı olabileceklerini, hatta daha da başarılı olabileceklerini öğretme konusunda da bir şekilde zorluk yaşadık demiyorum ama bu da challenge'lardan birisi olarak gerçekleşti. Onun haricinde klasik diğer sosyal kurumlarla, organizasyonlarla tabii ki işbirliği yapıyoruz. İşte TÜSİAD'da mesela kadına şiddet karşıtı grubunda yer alıyoruz. Bu da benzer bir sürü grupta farklı arkadaşlarımız rol alıyor. Bu da arkadaşlarımızın aidiyetini ve konuyu sahiplenmesini artırıyor. Burada belirtmek istediğim yaptığımız bize göre iyi örneklerden birisi şu. Özellikle bizim gibi sektörlerde kadın mühendislerin üniversite çıkışlarındaki oranına baktığınız zaman zaten bir zorluk var. Biz mesela bunun üstesinden gelmek için üniversitelere verdiğimiz mentorluk programlarında, üniversitelerden aldığımız stajyer programlarında ve üniversitelerden belirlediğimiz potansiyel, daha sonrasında işe almak için hedeflediğimiz arkadaşlarımızın listesinde çok net şekilde kız öğrencilere pozitif ayrımcılık yapıyoruz. Çünkü amacımız üniversitedeki oran ne olursa olsun yeni mezun alımlarımızda %50-%50 erkek kadın dengesini yakalamak ve oradan gerçekten nitelikli kızlarımızı, kız öğrencilerimizi yakalamak için özel proje yapıyoruz. Hani erkeklerde bunu yakalamanız daha kolay o sayısal fazlalıklarından dolayı ama özellikle mühendisler arasında kadın nitelikli kadın çalışan bulmakta zorlanıyoruz. Dolayısıyla yapılması gereken aksiyonlardan bir tanesinin de üniversitelerde belli mesleklerin kadın kız öğrenciler arasında teşvik edilmesi gerekliliği olduğunu düşünüyorum. Özellikle bu teknoloji konusunda siz de bahsettiniz ama yani o blokaj noktalarından birisi. Son bir aksiyonu sizlerle paylaşıp sözü iade edeceğim. Biraz da uzattım, özür dilerim. En son hayata geçirdiğimiz inisiyatifimiz global aile izin politikası. O da şu, aslında bu ucunda kadınlara dokunan ama erkeklere de bir şekilde tanımlanan bir politika. Erkeklerin doğum izinlerini biz şirket olarak globalde 2 haftaya çıkardık. Bunun buradaki temel amaç aslında ailenin bir paylaşım ortamı olduğunu, erkeklerin de bu sorumlulukta bir payı olduğu mesajını vermek. Artı gerek erkeklere gerek kadınlara çocuklarının hastalığında, ailede bir büyük vefatında kanunlara yani regülasyonun yoluna bakmadan 2'şer haftalık izinler tanımladık. Dolayısıyla paylaşımı artırarak aslında hayatın bir eşit paylaşım olduğu mesajını erkeklerimize vererek konuyu biraz ilerletmeye çalışıyoruz. Muhtemelen söz bir daha gelmeyecek diye son bir şey söyleyeyim. Bu konuda aşılması gereken gerçeklerden bir tanesi hani bu geçtiğimiz panel ve bu paneli katılımcıların da örnek alarak söylemek istiyorum. Aslında erkeklerin bunu sahiplenmesini de sağlamak. Yani erkekler bu konulardaki aksiyonları gerçekten işte bir kısım araştırmalar var. Meral Hanım belki de bahsedecek ama gerçek şu, erkeklere sorduğunuzda hepsi %80-90'ı destekliyor. Aksiyona çevirdiğinizde katılım oradaki o motivasyon düşük aslında. Dolayısıyla erkeklerin de bu aksiyonları sahiplenme konusunda motivasyonunu artırıcı bir kısım önlemler alındığında çok daha hızlı yol alınacaktır diyerek sözü size iade ediyorum ve teşekkür ediyorum.
Çok teşekkür ederim. Çok teşekkürler. Schneider Elektrik bir şeyi çok doğru yapıyor. Biz kadın istihdamı dediğimiz zaman insanların aklına gelebilen ve de yanıltıcı olan ne kadar çok bir şirketin kadını işe aldığı zannediyoruz. Oysa ki bu değil. Bu kadın nerelerde işe alınıyor? Yani horizontal olarak hangi sektörlerde işe alınıyor bu kadın? Artı nasıl yükseliyor? İşe alınıyor, yukarı çıkıyor mu? Kaç sene sonra bu azalmaya başlıyor? Devam ediyor mu? Promosyon oluyor mu? Ve özellikle de decision making positions, yapamadım. Orada asıl kadınlar var mı? En önemlisi de bu. Sözü Najma'ya veriyorum. Najma, Gulf African Bank. Gulf African Bank kadın bankacılığı konusunda harika işler yapan bir banka, Kenya'dan.
Thank you so much. It's an honor to be here. I want to mention UNWomen. Thank you for giving us this opportunity. I just have a small presentation. Is it showing? Anyway, I wanted to start by explaining Gulf African Bank. We are based in Kenya, Africa. We are the first Sharia compliant bank in Kenya, and we've been operating for the last 10 years. Several of our shareholders include IFC, PTA Bank, Bank Muscat, and we have, there it goes, 17 branches across Kenya. And those are our shareholders, which I had mentioned before. We have Dubai World, IFC, PTA Bank. We are a bank that is focused on women empowerment with a lot of emphasis on ensuring that there is economic empowerment of women in Kenya. And what has advised us, a lot of people ask us, why would a bank focus on women and deliberate effort to ensure that we have more women banking with us? One of the reasons, of course, is if you look at research across the world, is that women are good paymasters. If you finance a woman, research has shown that more women pay, and there's a very low NPL level among women in the banking sector, including our own statistics at Gulf African Bank, very low NPLs among the women-owned businesses and on individual capacity as well. Another reason why we really focus on women banking is that women are very loyal customers. If you make one woman happy, she tends to bring everybody on board, her family, her children, all her network as well. A second reason why we focus on women banking. Another thing amongst so many other reasons why we focus on banking on women is to be in line with the SDGs, goal number 5. And Kenya specifically, we have our own Vision 2030 that focuses on women empowerment. So we as Gulf African Bank said, as private sector, what role can we play in ensuring that there is equality and gender parity in Kenya? So I just thought it's interesting as well to show with the statistics of Kenya where women owned businesses are. So if you look at statistics done in 2016, it shows 1.56 million registered businesses in Kenya. So these are those sole traders, partnership companies, and out of these, 32% are owned and managed by women, which is a good statistics for us. Then when you look further into the statistics, you'll see the unregistered space, whereby we have about 5 million unregistered businesses in Kenya. And out of this, 60.7% comprises of women-owned businesses. So this is where it gets worried, because the women are operating in business, but majority of the women are operating on the unregistered space. So they are left out on so much opportunity. Another statistic that I thought is interesting, and this was given to us by IFC, is that out of all these women-owned businesses, 43% don't have any form of relationship with banking institutions in Kenya. So this means the women are left out on any form of access to capital, access to funds to expand their businesses. So as Gulf African Bank, this is the statistics we use to define and to develop our women banking program. And the major question we asked ourselves is, how do we make women prosper? How do we make them from the unregistered to registered? How do we make the women in Kenya access banking services? And that's what advised our program. So at that point, this was about 4 years ago, we partnered up with IFC, who are also our shareholders, and we did a lot of research and focus group discussions across Kenya to find out what is the reason there's low uptake of financial services among Kenyan women, why are they not accessing banking services, and based on that, we came up with a three-pillar customer value proposition: empower, protect, and educate the women. So when we made this deliberate effort, we of course had to look for strategic partners, and our key strategic partner for the last 2 years has been UNWomen. We've partnered up with Goldman Sachs, IFC, and others. But a key partner for us has been UNWomen. We became signatories to the Women Empowerment Principle 2 years ago. And as a bank, we made a deliberate effort that we are going to walk the talk. We are not only signatories, but we also champion principle number 5 of the WEPs in Kenya. We are the champions for that. So when we became champions for the Women Empowerment Principle, and in particular principle number 5, we sat with UNWomen and we asked ourselves, where is the biggest opportunity for women-owned businesses in Kenya? And the biggest opportunity is in the supply chain. So the government of Kenya has allocated 30% of all its tenders to women, youth, and persons of disability, and its spend is in trillions of Kenya money. So we said the government has done that, so that's where the opportunity is for women. And if we want to upscale the women, then we should be holding their hands to make sure that they do access these tenders. The second thing we said, it's just not the opportunity in government, but there's also a huge opportunity in the private sector. So how do we then move the women-owned enterprises, not just to access the opportunity in government, but from private sector as well? And of course, the question UNWomen asked us is, you are the champion of women empowerment in Kenya, and you are championing this principle. How much business is Gulf African Bank giving to women? So, of course, we didn't have the answer, and that's where our project started from, looking internally at Gulf African Bank and seeing how much opportunity from our own spend are we giving women on businesses. So it's been a journey. The first journey, of course, we started by looking at our policy, and we amended our procurement policy to include diversity and inclusivity in that space. The second thing that, as we were looking at the policy, is first of all, we had to define who is a woman-owned business. So internally, we defined a woman-owned business. It has to be one that is owned 50% plus by woman, and the woman is active in the operation of the business. And upon defining who's a woman-owned business, then we have been operating in Kenya for the last 10 years. So we went back to all our archives and looked at all the suppliers and gone through each Memax to determine among the companies we deal with how many are owned and managed by women. And of course, the statistics was terrible. So when we went historically, only 4% of our supplies we were getting from women-owned businesses. And upon that point is when our managing director made a commitment that we will make a deliberate effort to ensure that by the end of this year, 20% of our supplies goes to women-owned business. And in 2018, we're going to make sure that it's 30%. So when we were dealing with this program with UNWomen, the other question is, okay, we've opened up our own internal procurement. What do women need to make sure that they actually access these tenders? So we've been holding capacity building programs in conjunction with UNWomen across Kenya. We've been to several towns and actually trained about 670 women-owned businesses on several aspects. First of all, how do they become procurement ready? As we, my previous statistics shows, a lot of the women-owned businesses in Kenya are on the unregistered space, so automatically they are left out of the opportunity. So we train women on how do you register your business, what is the advantage of doing that. Secondly, we teach them how do you apply for a tender. It's very intimidating, you know, you get all this stack of paper that you need to fill. So we train, we demystify it for women and make it simple for them. There's nothing extraordinary, you're being asked on the tender document, so we actually take women through this. So that is the second aspect of the program we are running with UNWomen. And the third thing, of course, is once the women get tenders, they do need financing to be able to deliver the tenders. And as a financial institution, of course, that's the other hat we wear in this program. So if you look at the Kenyan statistics, when you go to a financial institution, the banks will ask for collateral, security. And in Kenya, a major form of security is land. If you look at the FIDA report for Kenya, only 1% of the registered land in Kenya is registered under a woman's name. So a major challenge in Kenya for women to access financing is lack of collateral. So what we've done is developed financing products that are unsecured for women to the tune of 20 million. So they are able to access tenders for that amount without providing security. We do a lot of contract management. How do we make sure that women are able to upscale? If you get the first tender with ₸1 million, how do we make sure that you get 100 million, 1 billion? How do we upscale and make sure that women get repeat and bigger tenders? So we have a lot of programs as well. We have branches for women only, so from the guard to the tellers to the relationship managers, it's all managed by women, just to be able to create an environment where women feel that this is the bank for us and we're able to access financial services. I thought as well to share, we have a robust website for women, a lot of initiatives within the three pillars. So on the website for women, we've partnered up with UNWomen again, and they've seconded some of their experts within their panel. And what the women need to do is just log in, and you're able to get financial advice, personal advice, on any aspects of your business. And we've also partnered up with other partners on a personal note, like doctors, lawyers, to be able to give the women financial advice. Knowledge Hub, this is something else we've worked with UNWomen, and we actually access journals, articles from UNWomen, and we filter what is relevant to the Kenyan woman today, and we give them access through our own website. Banking solutions for women, networking, whereby we feature women who have done well in male-dominated sector in Kenya, like transport and all this sector, and just to be able to show women that you can make it in any sector that you choose to. And some of these women have actually given their contacts, and the women are able to contact them. And of course, lots of capacity building programs within our ANISA program. Thank you.
Thank you very much. So as we can see, companies advance gender equality and women's empowerment different ways. Sometimes they do it in their communities, or they do it at the workplace with the suppliers program, or they sometimes, and best of it, they align their commitment of women customers with women employees. And actually, I had a set of questions, but I will pass this question because we're late. But our guests came very far away. Maybe you may want to ask them some questions instead of myself going with stage ones. If not, we have to end this year. Yes, please. There.
Paul Levin, Stockholm University. Coming from a Scandinavian country, my understanding and experience is that childcare was extremely important in order to allow Swedish women to enter the labor market. I'm wondering what you think of this. This is something that's sort of on the political level, but I'm still would like your reflections on that.
I don't know, we are asking.
Just,
any of the panelists would like to answer that?
I make a few points. It is quite same in Turkey. Okay, one of the outcomes that we took out from Ease Her Life project was childhood. And it was, I didn't go in detail, but it was common, concerns of the woman, two things. The first one, childhood care, but the second one is to miss their promotion, growth, development opportunities because of having child. And for child caring, we, because of the size of our company, okay, we made a kind of agreement with some child caring, schools, and we support the women, the mothers in the company for this part. But from the other parts, we gave clear message to whole organization that pregnancy leave is not an acceptable reason for stopping promotion. And even there are some examples that during the interview process, okay, the candidate had the understanding that she's going to have a baby, and despite that, we recruited some pregnants to give the message to the organization that we support it. And today, in the interview process, if a candidate is pregnant, it is a kind of out of discussion that the manager or owner of the role can stop or can eliminate this candidate. Those are the messages that we are giving the organization and helping the woman to take care of their children, but actually to be 100%, dedicated to job and free of concerns in their mind. That's what we have experienced in my side.
Thank you. And we must complete our panel. Yeah, it's the lunchtime. Thank you to all our speakers. I would like to invite Mr. Hakan Avdan, member of Executive Board of UIP, General Manager of Investat, to present their awards. Thanks to all. And now you can enjoy your lunch. Thanks.